is the meaning of electronic configuration? What are we discussing when I say the word electronic configuration? Anyone? Okay, few students have even raised their hands. Okay, very well. Share, accept, and donate is the valency, Aishwarya. Yes, Rishi, very good. It is distribution of electrons shell wise. It is, yes, I'm getting the answers, a lot of answers, but whoever answer I see first, I just take their name. So you don't have to feel that when you are answering, I'm not calling out your name. Okay. So we were talking about electronic configuration, which means shell-wise distribution of electrons, where we spoke about few elements, their atomic number, and how electrons will be distributed in different shells, based on which we decide the valency. And when I say valency, valency is the number of electrons donated, accepted, or shared. Okay. Valency is the number of electrons donated, accepted, or shared, which means the combining capacity of the elements. And as far as I remember, till nitrogen, we have already discussed about the valencies. Yes. If the number of electrons in the last shell is 4, it is going to share the electrons. If it is having less than 4, it is going to donate, and more than 4, it is going to accept. Till here, everybody, I think you've made the table as well, isn't it? Did you all have made the table till here of hydrogen, helium, lithium? And as far as I remember, you also know the codes to remember the names of the elements, isn't it? Do we all know the code for the first 20 element? Yes or no? For those students who do not know the code, at least till nitrogen, I am going to tell you now. So please listen to me carefully. When I say hydrogen, what are we going to say for hydrogen? We're going to say hi. Very good. You're going to say hi, hello. Just make sure you're seeing the alphabets which are in red color carefully, so that you remember the names of the code. Hi, hello, listen, B, B, C, news. What is it? Hi, hello, listen, B, B, C, news. This is what we have done till here. Moving ahead, let us take the next element, which is oxygen, fluorine, neon, sodium, and magnesium. My dear students, sodium symbol is Na, because we are going to use which name? Why is the symbol of sodium Na? What is the name we are going to use here? Come on, come on. Yes, very good, Anman. It is natrium, which is the Latin name. And that is why we have taken the answer as Na. Okay, my dear students. So now let us quickly see the electronic configuration and the valencies. Now I want everyone to simply concentrate on the electronic configuration and give me the valency. Talking about oxygen, oxygen's electronic configuration is going to be 2,6. As we know this, I'm just keeping it aside so that we remember what is it going to do. If it is 2,6, if it is 2,6, then the valency is going to be what? The number of electrons in the last shell is more than 4. So to make the octet, it is going to accept the 2 electrons. Harshit, it will not be 6. The valency will be 2, because in the last shell, the number of electrons are 6, which is more than 4. So it is going to make the octet by accepting 2 electrons. That is why the valency becomes 2. Is it clear to everyone? So there are two terms which I can ask you in this thing, is that if I ask you what is the valency, you're going to tell me it is 2. And if I ask you what is the valence electron, it is going to be 6. Let me repeat it once again. I am discussing the same element, which is oxygen. Number of electrons are 8. And if I want to shell-wise distribute these electrons, it becomes 2,6. Because the first shell is already stable, the second shell, which is containing more than 4 electrons, so definitely it is going to try to achieve the octet. And because it is trying to achieve the octet, which means 8 electrons, to make it 8, 6 needs more 2 electrons. So it is going to accept 2 electrons, which becomes its valency. I hope I have made this very clear now. Is it okay for everyone? Did you all understand what is the meaning of valency now? Okay. Now, let us try to get the answer for fluorine. I assume that majority of you already know this, and I'm pretty sure everybody is able to understand as well. So fluorine, which is 2,7. Arman, please stop. Electronic configuration is 2,7. So we get 7 in the last shell. 7 is the valence electron. VK Arman Shah, if you don't stop it, I will be forced to remove you from the lecture. So I would request you to stop asking me again and again the same thing. So 2,7 is the electronic configuration. 7 electrons in the last shell, it is going to accept 1 electron, so the valency becomes 1. Similarly for neon, electronic configuration is 2,8. So come on, tell me, what is the valency for neon? The valency of neon will be 0. Very good, because it's already stable. It has completed its duplet and octet, so the valency is 0. Very well. So let us move ahead with sodium quickly. So how are we going to distribute the electrons of sodium? How are we going to distribute the number of electrons for sodium? Yes, it's going to be 2,8,1. Because the second shell has maximum capacity of 8 electrons, so we are forced to put 1 electron in the third shell. Just give me a minute, my dear students, please. Till then, I feel that after magnesium, if you can do, you can please complete it. Okay, sorry. So let us quickly begin once again. I had just had to take a break of a minute or two. Now you can hear me because I had muted myself, and I hope that everybody is able to hear me now. So quickly moving ahead, we know the valency of sodium is going to be 1. Similarly, the valency of magnesium, where the electronic configuration is 12. So we distribute the electrons. It becomes 2,8,2, and the valency becomes 2. I hope till here everybody is clear, and you also know the code for this, which is, in the previous thing we were talking about hi, hello, listen, BBC news. Now it becomes on Friday night. For sodium, we are going to say naughty, and for magnesium, we are going to say Mowgli. What are we going to say? Naughty Mowgli. Yes, my students are already aware of all this. So let us quickly move ahead with the rest elements here. Now, I don't think I need to give you the electronic configuration and valency, because I assume that everybody sitting out there is able to know the valencies, isn't it? Yes, Kirti, will you be able to answer us any question? If I ask you, let me ask you to unmute yourself and answer one question. For aluminium, Kirti Gupta, will you unmute yourself and tell me what is the valency of aluminium? VK Kirti Gupta, will you unmute yourself and tell me what is the valency of aluminium? If you're able to switch on your video, I feel it should be easier for you to unmute yourself and answer the question. It's a very simple question. Disappeared. Why, students? Why? Are they difficult questions? I don't think so. I know majority of you want to answer. You're already typing me and showing me the answer, which is very impressive. So have you all written these elements? First, tell me that. Have you all written these elements in your notebook? Yes, very good. Because we need this every point of time when we'll be writing the formulas of the chemicals elements combined together. So let us quickly get the answers. Electronic configuration for aluminium is going to be 2,8,3. So accordingly, the valency becomes 3. Similarly, for silicon, yes, Saida Maria, you can answer. For silicon, you can unmute yourself and answer the question. No happening. Okay, anyways, no problem. I think you're still typing and giving the answer. That's absolutely fine for me. Silicon, which is atomic number 14, becomes 2, 8, 4. So the valency becomes 4. Similarly, phosphorus 15, 2, 8, 5. The valency becomes, will the valency be 5 now? Will the valency be 5? No, the valency is going to be 3, Janvi, because more than 4, it is going to accept the 3 electrons to get this octet. When you say 5, it becomes the valence electron. Yes, Ayan, ask me, what doubt do you have? When it is having 5 electrons in the last shell, it is going to accept 3 electrons to become stable. Is it okay? Whatever doubt you have, you can type and show it to me so that I can see in the chat box and answer your question. If you want to see the previous slide, I will show you a little later. First, let me finish this thing. Sulfur, 2, 8, 6. Similarly, the valency will become, what will be the valency? 2. Very good. Next one, chlorine, 2, 8, 7. Valency becomes 1. And argon is 2, 8, 8. And the valency becomes 0. Very nice. Very well. So let us quickly get the code for all the first 18 elements. Now the question few students were asking me that, do we need to remember the electronic configuration? Yes, you have to remember, but you don't have to by heart the electronic configuration. What is the easier way to remember is the code which I am giving you now, which is starting from the element hydrogen, which says, hi, hello, listen, B, B, C, news on Friday night. Then we said naughty Mowgli. In the previous slide, we had sodium and magnesium, which were corresponding to naughty Mowgli. Always sings, as you can see here, aluminium always sings pop songs claimed by A.R. Rahman. You can say A.R. Rahman, Arijit Singh, whatever is comfortable for you. But you need to remember the symbols of the elements. Now, why are we learning them in order? The question is, why are we learning them in order? So that at any point, if I directly ask you, what is the atomic number of magnesium? What is the atomic number of magnesium? How will you say? Let me repeat the code once again for you. Hi, hello, listen, B, B, C, news on Friday night. Then comes naughty Mowgli. So Mowgli, which is Mg, comes at position 12. That is why the atomic number of magnesium becomes 12. Once you know the atomic number, you will be in the position to give me the electronic configuration, which is 2, 8, 2. And once we know the electronic configuration, we can easily get the valency. Yes, I have given this code to majority of the students who were there in 8th standard with me. And I'm pretty sure you're always aware of this code. Some different code as well. It's absolutely fine. Which code are you using to remember the elements is not priority. Important is you should know the atomic numbers, because if we know the atomic number, we'll be able to get the valency. Is it clear, everyone? I'm repeating once again. Hi, hello, listen. B, B, C, news on Friday night. Naughty Mowgli always sings pop songs claimed by A.R. Rahman. Is it okay? Is it okay, my dear students? Very well. Moving ahead, now we know the valencies, but we need to know something more other than the valencies. Now, what is that? Let us try to understand. We are going to talk about a term which is called as variable valency. What are we going to talk about? Variable valency. Now, what is the meaning of variable? As you all know, valency is the number of electrons which is donated, accepted, or shared. And variable is the term that is, it is going to have more than one valency. More than one valency means what? Under different conditions, my dear students, the atoms of some elements either give away or take up the number of electrons. Sometimes, you know, where are these electrons? Where are these elements found in nature? They are found in different places. Some are found in Earth's crust, isn't it? Some are obtained from the sea salt generators. So these elements, under which conditions they are observed in nature, is different. According to those conditions, these atoms of some elements either give away or take up different number of electrons. In such cases, those elements exhibit more than one valency. These elements exhibit more than one valency, and that is the property of element which is called as variable valency. If you have understood something about variable valency, let me show you a few examples of the elements which exhibit variable valency, which you are going to remember. Now, these are the elements that exhibit variable valency. I want everyone to strictly see this slide right now. Do not write anything. Do not chat anything. Just listen to me. I have these elements which are copper, mercury, and iron. Which are these elements? Copper, mercury, and iron. As you can see, copper, I have written two valencies, which are 1 and 2. Which are 1 and 2. Mercury is also having two valencies, 1 and 2. And iron is also having two valencies, but that is 2 and 3. Now, to name these elements, the element with lower valency, let us take the example of copper. Is everyone looking at copper right now? When you see copper, the valency 1 is the lower one, right? Valency 1 is the lower one and 2 is the higher one. So the lower valency's name always end with O-U-S. So copper becomes cuprous with valency 1 and cupric with valency 2. Remember, it's not related to the number. It is related to the lower valency. Because copper's lower valency is 1, one valency is called as cuprous and two valency is called as cupric. Similarly, for mercury, there are two valencies, which are 1 and 2. So if you write any compound which is containing element mercury with valency 1, the name of the compound should start with mercurous. And if it's with valency 2, it will be called as mercuric. Do not worry, I am explaining it once again. Now let us try to concentrate on iron. I want everyone to just look at iron, which is Fe. Fe is an element with two valencies, which are 2 and 3. Now, among 2 and 3, tell me which is the lower valency. It's a simple question, right? The valency 2 is the lower one, isn't it? So, any compound which will be formed when valency 2 is taken into consideration, the name of the compound will become ferrous. Like, for example, ferrous sulfate, ferrous oxide, ferrous nitrate, and so on. But if valency 3 is taken, the name of the compound will become ferric nitrate, ferric sulfate, and ferric oxide. I hope I am trying to make it simpler for you. Lower valency will end with O-U-S and higher valency will end with I-C. And you have to remember only these three elements from examination point of view. It will be definitely asked in the exam. Copper, mercury, and iron. Repeat everyone. Copper, mercury, and iron are the elements with variable valency. Copper has two valencies, 1 and 2. Mercury has two valencies, again 1 and 2. Iron has two valencies, 2 and 3. If the question is arising in your mind, that ma'am, how will I come to know which valency should be taken when the reaction is happening? And do not worry about that. Whenever we are doing reactions of copper, mercury, and iron, I am going to tell you what are the conditions required to take the valency as 1 or take the valency as 2. Is it okay? Still, I feel if you're not able to understand, let us start from the basics once again. Just now, we discussed about valency. Right? We simply said valency is the number of electrons donated, accepted, or shared to become stable. Is that clear? Only the word valency is clear to everyone. The term valency is clear to everyone, right? Where we were discussing only one valency. Now I am talking about variable valency. Variable valencies are exhibited by only few elements because the conditions in which they are extracted from the Earth's crust changes. That is why their valency also changes. Depending upon the condition in which it is going to react, that is why they exhibit more than one valency. And because the electronic configuration concept which you have studied, it is applicable only till element 20. After that, the electronic configuration also changes, which belong to these elements, copper, mercury, and iron. And when you go to a higher standard, you will study much in detail about this variable valencies. For now, you just have to remember the names of these three elements and their variable valencies. Is it okay? And I will tell you which valency you are supposed to take when you are making the formulas. As we move ahead and we solve the examples, it will become very clear to you what is the term of variable valency. For now, everyone, this slide which I'm showing you, quickly write in your notebook, which I assume majority of you would have already written, and you might also be having in your textbook. Symbol of mercury, remember, it's hydragyrum. It's the Latin name, which is Hg. Mg is the symbol for magnesium. Is it clear? Mg is the symbol for magnesium. It is not for mercury. Mercury has symbol Hg. See, students, I'm going stepwise so that the concept of valency gets very clear to you. Till now, we were discussing about valencies of only one element. Like iron is one element, oxygen is one element, nitrogen is one single element. Now we'll move ahead when the valencies are combined together of two elements. Let us see what are they called as. Latin name of mercury is called as hydragyrum. Okay, I'll wait for the students to complete writing. Nomenclature means naming of element, because one student is asking me this question, which we'll be studying in the next grade, that is 10th standard. Mercury, Hg, full form is hydragyrum. That is the Latin name for mercury. That is why the symbol becomes Hg. Copper is cuprum, iron is ferrum. These are the Latin names and their symbols. They have multiple valencies because depending upon the conditions under which they are extracted from the earth's crust. That is why they have multiple valencies. No, you do not have to write the previous slide. You just have to write this slide which I am showing you. Yes, Ayan, you are correct. It is P-H-O-S, P-H-O-R-U-S. Yes, I gave only 18 because we'll talk about potassium and calcium a little later on. Copper, Cu symbol is because its Latin name is cuprum. From that we get the symbol. This slide is there in the textbook. Do not worry. But I would request you to write it down because writing gives you practice. I think by now everybody has finished writing. Moving ahead, first you have to listen to your teacher carefully and then ask questions. Okay? First listen to me carefully when I'm talking about this word ion. We've spoke about atoms, right? Atoms which are electrically neutral. They're electrically neutral because they have same number of electrons and same number of protons. These atoms or molecules with a positive or negative charge are called as ions. And how they get converted into ions is because they either donate or accept electrons. We have discussed this term before. Because they donate or accept electron, they get converted into ions. By donating electrons, they get a charge which is positive. And by accepting electrons, they get a charge which is negative. So positively charged ions, my dear students, are called as cations. And negatively charged ions are called as anions. This is just a recap of what we have done before. Cations are positive charge. Like I said, how I remember is, when I see a cation, the T symbol helps me remember it's the positive sign. And for anion, I remember it as a negative ion. It's totally up to you in which way you want to remember. But what you need to remember is cations are positive and anions are negative. Is it clear, everyone? So we've spoke about what are atoms, what are ions, what are valencies. Now we are going to talk about compounds with ionic bonds having two constituents. In first place, what is an ionic bond? The bond which is formed by cations and anions together, when they combine together, when they interchange their valencies, we get a bond which is called as ionic bond. Ionic bonds are nothing but which are formed because of ions. And compounds means what? Compounds is formed by combining two or more elements together. So compounds with ionic bonds usually have two constituents. These are cations, which are positively charged, and anions which are negatively charged. They take part independently in a chemical reaction and therefore they are called as radicals. So my dear students, ions are also termed as radicals. Let us see the example here. I have given you a base. Can you see NaOH? Can everybody see NaOH, which is Na, sodium, O, oxygen, H, hydrogen. Now you have to distribute them into a cation and an anion. Now in this case, the radical, as we said, they have two constituents combined together. The cation becomes Na plus and the anion becomes OH minus. Very good. So OH is together, which is called as hydroxide. So this is what the radical means. Two constituents combined together having a charge. Similarly, tell me for KOH. What will it be for KOH? It will be K positive, very good, and OH negative. Very nice. So you all are able to get the hang of it. Similarly, CaOH twice. How are we going to write them? Ca 2 plus and OH minus. If the question is coming in your mind, ma'am, why did you write Ca 2 plus? Why there is 2 on top of Ca? This is because calcium donated 2 electrons to become stable. If there is 1 plus charge, if there is 1 plus charge, it means it has donated only 1 electron. 2 plus charge means it has donated 2 electrons. And if 3 plus charge, that means it has donated 3 electrons. This is how the numbers are given at the top of the atom. Did you all understand how are we going to represent it? If you have understood this, let me quickly tell you. You can also write it as Ca plus plus, or you can also write it as Ca 2 plus. Both the things are correct. Both the things are correct. This is the chart which has been asked is as a question in your textbook. The blank chart given to you. So if you want, you can make this table in your notebook quickly and write the answers. OH is minus because it has become stable by accepting electron. Similarly for acid, HCl, it will be H plus Cl minus. HBr is going to be H plus Br minus. And HNO3 is going to be H plus and NO3 together minus. Now this 3, NO3, the 3 number is associated with oxygen itself. It's a compound, it's a radical which is called as nitrate, which has the formula NO3. Here the 3 will not be given to H again. I will explain radicals once again, do not worry. But HNO3, please take care, it is H plus and NO3 minus. The 3 which is given here is associated with oxygen itself. And we are going to have a whole set of table for ions and radicals which needs to be by-hearted by everyone sitting here. So when I am talking about radicals, it is seen from the above chart, my dear students, that different bases such as sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide are formed when various cationic radicals are paired with different anionic radicals like hydroxide. So these cationic radicals, when they are paired with different anionic radicals, they are termed as basic radicals. So when you see a positive charge, positive charged ions are also called as cations and they're also called as basic radicals. The other term for cationic ions are also called as basic radicals. Similarly, for negatively charged, which are anions, they are called as acidic radicals. You don't have to write everything which is given here. You just have to make this table and you have to write cationic radicals are also called as basic radicals and anionic radicals are also called as acidic radicals. Only these two statements and the table, nothing else. Are you all writing or taking screenshots? See, radicals are nothing but a different name which is given to these ions only. Radicals is a different name which is given to these ions only. The only difference is when I have a positively charged, I say it's a cation, and I can also call it as a basic radical. If I have a negative charge, I will call it as an anion, or it will be also called as an acidic radical. We are still yet to finish with radicals. We have to learn about different types of radicals now. I told you to only make the table and write the statement that cationic radicals are called as basic radicals and anionic radicals are called as acidic radicals. Only this much you are supposed to write. Nothing more than that. I assume that I think I gave you enough time to complete this. Now, quickly moving ahead, let us see what are the types of radicals here. As you can see, I've given you examples of monoatomic radicals. When I say mono, means one atom like sodium, copper, chlorine. They're simple radicals because they're monoatomic, where only single atom is having a charge. Similarly, when the radical is a group of atoms carrying a charge, such as SO4 together, which is having a charge negative and valency 2, NH4 plus charge positive valency 1, they will be called as composite radical. So in radicals, we have two things. One is called as simple radical, one is called as composite radical. What are the two things? Simple radical, composite radical. And what is the meaning of simple radical? Simple means simple, single atom having a charge. But when there are more than two atoms combined together, and if they have a charge, then I will call it as composite radical. Is it clear, types of radical now? Is the types of radical clear to you? First of all, see, let me revise it once again. Do not panic and let me revise once again. Just simply listen to me. Do not rush in writing. I'll tell you when to write and I'll give you enough time. Just listen to me. We spoke about ions, which are two charges. One is positive, one is negative. These ions which are having positive charge are called as cations. Just like the cations have a positive charge, similarly, basic radicals are the ones which are having positive charge. Anions are the ones which have negative charge. So acidic radicals are the ones which have negative charge. Under radicals, we are studying two types. One are simple radicals and one are composite radicals. Simple radicals is the table which you have studied just now, the table from 1 to 18. Those all were simple radicals because they were only single atom carrying a charge. But now we are going to learn about a table which is having two elements combined together and having a charge, which is composite radical. On top of any atom or an element, if you see a charge, if it's only plus, it is monovalent. Single plus tells me it's monovalent. Mono means one, valent means valency. That is one valency. If it is two, I will call it as divalent. Or bivalent. Both the terms are same. If it's three, I will call it as trivalent. And if it's four, I will call it as tetravalent. Mono, bi, tri and tetra. And please do not ask me what will be the word for 5, because we all know the valency never exceeds 4. If it's more than 4, then they start accepting electrons. So valency again becomes 3, 2, 1, 0. Is it clear? So if I have to simplify all this, cations are the basic radicals, anions are the acidic radicals. And simple radicals are those which contains only single atom, and composite are two atoms combined together. I hope I am trying to simplify all these things for you. Is it clear, my dear students, what is composite and what is simple? Yes, do not write all this. Let me show you one slide here. Okay. If you all are having your textbook, this is on textbook page number 56. Sorry, give me a minute. There's some lagging happening here. Okay, so let us come here again. I want everyone to see this slide here. If you're having a textbook, this is on textbook page number 66. You do not have to write this. Please just listen to what I'm saying. I want everyone to concentrate on the screen right now because you have to understand what are you supposed to learn from this. This table is of ions and radicals. As you can see, I put a slash in between ions and radicals because they both mean the same. Isn't it? And here on the left hand side, they have given all basic radicals, and on right hand side, they have given all acidic radicals. Left hand side is basic radicals, right hand side is acidic radicals. Basic radicals, as we all can see, are the positively charged radicals, and acidic radicals are the ones which are negatively charged radicals. Under basic, we have all the types like simple and composite. Similarly, it is under acidic also. There is no underline here. The underline, if you're seeing, is just a differentiation which has been made that the before this, after mercurius, we start with number 2, and after gold, it comes number 4. There is no underline here. It's just a bifurcation to show that first all valency 1 are given, then all valency 2 are given, then the second column, valency 3 are given, followed by valency 4, and the last one. If you observe carefully, basic radicals have only one composite radical, which is NH4+. Basic radical is only one, which is having NH4+. That is the only composite radical. Whereas in acidic radicals, we have lot of composite radicals. I know this topic is getting little difficult for you because this is the step where we are trying to understand how to make the formulas for chemical reactions. If you understand this, my dear students, chemistry will become really simple for you. But whenever you're learning a little difficult thing for the first time, it takes time to understand. So do not panic and just make a conclusion that we don't like chemistry, we don't understand anything. Just wait and give time it to understand. Give time to sink in to understand, okay? There is only one. It is not that it is only one. There are many because we are already studying 118 elements. Imagine from those elements, how many ions and radicals we can make. This is the list of ions and radicals which will be used by you in this academic year as well as next year. Only these elements we are going to take into consideration. That is why it's a list of those ions and radicals. It is not possible for me to give you time to write this right now. So I would request you to take a screenshot if you want for this one, or you can see it from the textbook. But I would request everyone to make a chart out of it and just place it on anywhere where you're going to see it every day, because this table has to get by heart. I know it's difficult, so it won't be able to by heart at one go. One day suddenly you sit and try to by heart everything, it's not possible. You have to give it time. So why don't we do this way, that these are 4 columns, right? Let us try to remember one column every day. So I think in 4 days, we'll be done through it. Now, composite ones from the acidic one, you can make out, right? Like hydroxide, nitrate, nitrite, everything is composite. Because what is the meaning of composite, Mrunal? It is 2 atoms combined together, no? So anything where there are 2 atoms combined together, it will become a composite one. Did you understand the gist of the table, how you're going to learn? Now, if I ask you, what is the type of question being asked on this table? If I ask you, directly I'll ask you, tell me sulfate. If I ask you, what is sulfate? Your answer will be SO42-. SO42-. Where the formula is itself SO4. The entire formula is SO4, charge negative valency 2. Are you understanding my terms? Formula is SO4, charge is negative, and valency is 2. If you're able to remember this valency before my next class, it will be really nice, so that once you know the formula, and if I ask you how to make the formula, let us try once again. Tell me, can you all locate sodium? Can everybody locate sodium? Can everybody locate sodium? You all can see sodium, which is Na, charge is positive, valency is 1. Now, can you locate chloride? Now, can you locate chloride? Did you all find chloride? See third column acidic radicals. Can you see chloride? Yes, it is Cl minus. Very good. So we know Na plus and Cl minus. So my question is, tell me the chemical formula of sodium chloride. I will ask you sodium chloride. Sodium is positive, chlorine is negative. Both have valency 1. Interchange the valencies and we get the formula as NaCl. Now, did you understand what is the table being used for? If not, let me give you one example here and make it very clear. Let's try to make chemical formulae of compounds. Let me quickly just take one example. Give me a minute. Okay, here. We are making for potassium chloride. I hope everybody has the table with them. If not, I've already given you here. Potassium is K, chlorine is Cl. Potassium valency 1, chlorine valency 1. Interchange their valencies. K is 1, Cl is 1. But when both the numbers are 1, do not show the number 1. You will simply write KCl. Because when nothing is written, it is understood the number is 1. Is it clear? Still, if you're finding it difficult, do not worry. Next lecture, entirely, I'm going to dedicate only for writing the formulas because that is the most important part of chemistry. When you don't understand writing formulas, you'll not understand anything. So for next class, I would request you all to please try to learn the valency chart and come so that it becomes easier for all of us to understand the chemical formulas. Is it okay? I know that today's lecture might have got a little difficult for you, but do not worry. Gradually, when we read this every day, it will become easy. Yes, my dear students, thank you so much for listening to me. And few students who have repeatedly irritated me in the class, I'll make sure